thing that no one likes is being killed by multiple players when you're alone. And so when I go and I kill multiple players alone, that's me giving back to all of you out there. You know, all of you, including me, because I've been killed multiple times by groups of two that just had, you know, equal gear to me. That was the difference there, is that they were so confident being together that they really weren't updating their gear. I slaughtered them gear-wise. But okay, I will definitely take it. I did not think I was going to find people, let alone two. I have searched all over Un'Goro, my friends. I searched all over Eastern and Western Plaguelands. I found nobody. I found one guy, actually, 53, but obviously too low for gear, so not something I'm going to do. And then I just randomly decided to come back to Fungal Rock and go back to the cave. That's where they pretend to be. This part of Un'Goro on the right side is where the most quests are for Ascension, because you'll level so fast, you never really go to the ones on the west side. Yeah. Oh my god, this is dead. Hey, it's people! I bet my mount's faster. Pay to win. Oh my god, pay to win! These aren't the same guys, right? I'm gonna go on the low health guy first. Don't forget that it's 1v2. Oh, I missed again! So one thing I've noticed, by the way, smoke bombed inside with me. You're in here with me. In other words, oh god, die! Die! Oh, I just missed my interrupt. I'm going hard. I have the combat readiness up. Come on, come on, come on, yes! Dude, I got loot from both. I think they're different people. Twisted Guardian Stone, so I can sell that. That's some high-risk stuff. And I got Basalt Necklace of the Bear with Relentless on it. So I just took this dude's legendary enchant on accident. I'm so sorry, man. It's only green, so I can't really do anything with it. I actually might be able to sell this because it's a necklace. And you might think to yourself, yeah, you know, 4 spirit sucks, but I'll take 4 strength and a free legendary enchant. You know, if I throw it up for 2G, some lowbie like level 30 who wants to try this build could do it. Yeah, you know, that might actually work. And then we got chest piece of the eagle, which is not terrible, but it kind of, it's...
Yep. So if I turn this off, what should I add? So why isn't that window being shown? All right, it's not showing the window. So let's see. That's Chrome. And Adobe Photoshop doesn't want me to do that. So, it's not allowing me to showcase the art, which is interesting because the display is right here. This is what I see. But when I use the window capture, that's what you'll see if I use the window capture. So I think that there are still a few issues to work out. Adobe CS display capture. All right, sound alerts, chat. I would add a window capture. Browser. No. Display. Where is window? Window. There we go. Thank you. believe it's this. Okay. And there. That should do. Hello there. Does it show that? Yes, it does. All right. So it's consistent with what it's capturing. So what if I make this big? Okay, good, 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 good. Well, I'm gonna put together a lineup that I like to listen to while I'm chilling out. Sometimes make a comment on it if I'm paying attention too much, but let's see. And play.
Every mod you see in this video will be linked in the description, as well as all the other mods from my previous showcase. I really like this mod because I do not like how the original Survey Corps outfit looks. Bro, what? The shoes ruin the look, bro.
Black.
This mod changes the agile style and strong style splashes that show up and replaces them with these kanjis. I can't read the language, so I'm gonna assume they don't say something terrible. So did anybody look at Irida and was like, damn bro, if only she was a Smurf? Well, I got you covered. Or what about this? I have a better question. Did you ever look at this dumb fuck and say, what if he was that guy from that anime? Well, now your questions have been answered. We now have orange red hair anime guy versus Papa Smurf zombie versus anime.
I have had to follow a set of rules to prove I am capable of being a loving wife and mother who wants only him.
Let's see. Winsicott.
What's going on, everybody? Hope everybody's feeling good. Hope everybody's doing well. We are back with another story post, guys. I'll put this up on the screen if you want to check it out.
What?
What? You guys read the title?
Okay, never mind.
Let's just get into it. So, Reddit relationship advice. I cheated on my husband, and he's been punishing me for it. I know I deserve it, but it's really difficult, and I need to discuss the terms of the punishment with him. I, 22-year-old female, cheated on my husband, 26-year-old male, with a coworker last year. I had sex with him once, but all the signs were there and I had done nothing to stop it. My husband had even expressed concerns about how close we were, and I had just shrugged it off. I confessed to my husband after it happened. We were both distraught, but obviously our pain wasn't the same, and I deserved mine. I thought we were going to divorce, but thankfully, my husband was kind enough to agree to reconcile. I have had to follow a set of rules to prove I am capable of being a loving wife and mother who wants only him. I had to quit my job. I have to share his phone. I have my own laptop, though. I'm not allowed to please myself or engage with any kind of erotic media. I can't have alcohol, and I can't leave the house alone. These rules have made my life miserable. I know I've made my own life miserable, and this is a really good way of ensuring that I love him and won't cheat again. But as we are heading into 2022, he said the rules aren't going to change anytime soon. I'm concerned for when our daughter is old enough to understand what's going on between us. How can I broach this subject with him without sounding like I want to get away with what I've done without consequences? There's a story on this channel. I'll link it if I can find it. I think the guy, was it? He had her go through a bunch of stuff. You know, like she had cheated on him and he had her go. It was savage. And looks like we have another one here that I came across online. So, woman, look, you begged him to reconcile. Please don't divorce me. Please, I need you. All right, I'll reconcile under one condition. Hey, this is how bad cheating is. You don't cheat on people. I would say he should have divorced your butt. Kicked you to the curb and got everything, you know, tried to do, get a good lawyer and got rid of you, you know. Ew. Like, you're giving your body to somebody else, and it's always this freaking coworkers. Man, ridiculous. So, you know, he should have divorced you. You're not worth it, you know. But he wants to torture you. He wants to make you feel miserable. He wants you to pay for what you did. And he's right. He should keep you. Hey, he's probably just trying to wait for you to break, you know, see how much you'll take. You wanted to reconcile. Okay, I'll reconcile under this condition, and this is what it is. If we can't do this, then it's a divorce. So, I don't know. Maybe now you want a divorce. I don't know. Guys, let's check out these comments. I wonder if she's in the comments. Someone said he is punishing you when he should have just divorced you. Yeah, I agree. He should have divorced her. Y'all need a divorce yesterday. You cheated on him when you were happy with him. You destroyed him, and now you are not happy? Why are you staying? Divorce him. He won't heal in your presence. It's good for both of you. You are both crab heads who don't deserve relationships, to be honest. Y'all can't handle commitments. These rules are to control you and won't solve his anger and distrust. He'll have the same anger in 20 years. You've messed up. But this is no way to live. Time to move on. Honestly, it sounds like you're still in a fair fog. If those think you miserable, just leave the guy. Fair fog is one thing, but dude has her on a metaphorical leash. If she can't leave the house alone, that doesn't make sense. He doesn't trust her. He's boomeranged into an abusive, controlling environment. Oh, now he's abusive. Here we go. This is a woman. Yeah, this is a woman saying this. Now he's being abusive. He's hurting her. He's not putting his hands on her. Look, if she wants to leave, she can leave. She can say, no, I'm not doing this stupid stuff, and walk away and divorce. He's not going to stop her. The thing is, she doesn't want a divorce. So he's like, okay, for what you did, you have to do this. And she's agreed to it. Oh, man. Nothing excuses her cheating, and she does deserve consequences for that, but has to be reasonable. Like being divorced or getting a new job and removing all contact with the affair partner, changing her number, etc. Being chaperoned or having her pleasure toy habits monitored is insensible. It's unusual punishment and not a healthy way for them to actually attempt reconciliation, if that's what they want to do. You reap what you sow. Where is she at? I want to see if she's in the comments, man. Okay, yeah, someone's asking her a question. Just the way you talk, I feel that you really do not want to stay. Maybe you're doing it for your kid, but you're not in it. Why did you cheat? And here she is. She's about to tell why she cheated, guys. Let's hear this excuse. No, I don't want to stay. I really love him a lot, although our daughter is part of it. It's just that I'm a little bit worn down for having been living like this. I want to heal our relationship, though, because I love him and our family. I said this to another commenter who was asking. I feel like this is the best I can explain it. I don't think I had a real reason for cheating. But to give one, I was very stressed as a new mother, and I was very afraid of the turn my life had taken. I felt like I had gone from a teen to a working mother without any time to adjust. Was not ready for all the stress life was throwing at me. My pregnancy was very hard for me, and I was incredibly anxious the whole time. I genuinely thought I was going to die, and I think both my husband and I thought that it would just go away after I had the baby, which it didn't. I also felt like my husband was very dismissive of my worries and feelings and not helping enough. These all, I think, contributed to the state of mind that allowed me to do what I did. Although none of these things are excuses. Wow. And the guy replied, so you felt that sex would fix that? Guys, let me know what you think about this in the comments. Look, he's not hurting her. He told her, you want to reconcile, do this. And she needs to do it. And if she doesn't want to do it, then we just get a divorce and move on and go our separate ways. It's that simple. It's that simple. Shout out to the Savage Gang out there. Savage Gang, shout out to you guys. Let me know what you think about this in the comments. Catch you guys in the next one.
Good luck paying for the car. Pro revenge. So this isn't my story. It happened to a friend of a friend, so exact details are difficult to get, but...
I have an interesting career. I get to watch cartoons for a living, something that many people consider a dream job. But there's a catch. Said cartoons and movies are typically obscure, bizarre, and more often than not, bad. Oh my God. Just terrible stuff. Why did I watch these stupid NFT cartoons? I lost my last two brain cells because of this trash. And I can't afford to buy new ones.
Later, babies.
But that is the cross that I bear. Just this past week, I watched Wizards vs. Children, an animated Russian propaganda cartoon that is supporting the Orthodox Church over there and was done in 2016, so it was pretty recent and pretty bad. I watched Fairview from Comedy Central, which was somehow even worse than the propaganda cartoon. And then I watched the most recent episode of the Jehovah's Witnesses cartoon called Caleb and Sophia. And guys, it broke me.
Why are you drunk?
But every so often, I stumble across something that is, indeed, obscure and bizarre, but is also good. That was the case when I reviewed Poppy the Performer. What a pleasant surprise that was. On the outside, I was expecting low-tier garbage, but instead, it was outstanding. A chaotic masterpiece. Fortunately for me, I am in that same situation once again. Let me tell you all about Ruchuban Ebichu, an anime with an outward appearance that is downright deceiving. Folks, this is not Hamtaro, okay? Let's just make that clear. I mean, at first, I thought it was, and was like, wait, what's Hamtaro doing? I don't remember this from my childhood. Oh God. Oh God. Yeah, Ebichu is not for kids at all. And I can't stop laughing at the idea of some poor parents who probably bought this anime thinking that it was cute and put it on the TV for their child, only to hear their kids scream in horror when not Hamtaro is bleeding out on the floor. Oh yes, I've been looking forward to talking about this one, guys. I legit had a ball watching this one. And now y'all get to hopefully enjoy it alongside with me. So put on your pants, grab some camembert cheese, or however you say it, and let's check out the chaotic and dirty world of Ebichu. So what are the origins behind Ebichu? First off, this was genuinely a fun topic to research, as it features one of those chance happenings that defines a movie or show. But we'll get to that here in a moment. Like most anime, Ebichu is based on a manga, which went by the same name. It was created by Risa Ito and was published in 1991 by Futubasha Publishers and ran for nearly two decades, with 15 volumes in total. I actually was able to read the manga before writing this video. And I gotta say, Ebichu the anime is an excellent adaptation. It was able to translate the same humor and style over to animation perfectly. But this would not have happened if it wasn't for a particular person, Kotono Mitsushi. Kotono here is a famous voice actor in Japan, and is known for providing her voice as Misato Katsuragi in Neon Genesis Evangelion.
Really?
And also as Usagi in Sailor Moon. So, the story goes that Kotono was reading the Ebichu manga during her recording sessions for Neon Genesis, and her contagious love for the sex comedy of Ebichu caught on with the other folks at the studio, and the anime industry was like, yo, we should do an Ebichu adaptation. And guess what? Kotono would be part of the show as the voice of Ebichu. The series itself was produced by Gainax and was animated by Group TAC. Now, there were only 12 episodes with 24 segments, but to me, that was plenty. Not too little, not too much, a good sweet spot. In 1999, it made its debut to the world via DirecTV in Japan and was aired uncensored. Ha ha ho, scandalous. As if there's any other way to watch this show, right? And that is the short and sweet origin of the Ebichu anime. Short and sweet, just like our dear little hamster girl, who isn't as sweet as you think. So, what's the show about? Well, it's a slice of life sex comedy about a cute little hamster named, you guessed it, Ebichu. Ebichu is bubbly, dedicated, emotional, but is also very dumb. Just downright dumb. and she's noisy and loud and lacks any verbal filter whatsoever. Like, she says whatever on her mind. She's a complete idiot. Her master, called Office Lady, or OL for short, is a 25-year-old office lady. She's sexually active. She smokes, she drinks, she loves cakes, she loves to go out with her boyfriend. We'll talk about him here in a second. But above all else, the office lady is self-conscious, and she longs for a husband before she gets any older. Apparently in Japan, if you're not married by 25 as a woman, people look down on you and think that you're not good enough. Damn, Japan, just chill out, right? All right, so that brings us to our third character, the boyfriend. This guy is scum. Through and through. It's one of the very few things that I agree with Ebuchu about, because she does not care for this guy whatsoever. He drinks, he smokes, he gambles, and he loves sex. He loves it so much that he'll do it with any hot girl that's willing to give it to him. Yeah, he's a cheater. And Ebuchu calls him worthless bum, and rightfully so. Ebuchu's master is constantly trying to lock this guy down in a commitment, but he plays with her head. Like in one episode, both of them are in bed together, and they're dreaming, and the guy is screaming out some girl's name, and the office lady's like, whoa, hold on, that's not my name. Who was that? Who's Artiko, or whatever the name was? And the guy's like, oh, I mean, I was dreaming about naming our future daughter together. And the girl fell for it! She's like, aw, what a sweet guy. Ebuchu saw right through it, though. It's so obvious that the girl is so desperate for a man and is willing to settle with this horrible guy who only sees her as a convenient booty call. Don't worry, folks. Ebuchu messes with the boyfriend, so he gets his occasionally. Though, unfortunately, the master will side with the boyfriend, and both of them will beat up on Ebuchu together. It's kind of funny, actually, but it sucks. I guess misery loves company. But yeah, this running string of Ebuchu's master trying to get married to the scummy guy is like the main overarching story element in this adult slice of life comedy. But hey, it works. Well, hold on. I guess there's one more overarching story here in the series, all right? And it's admittedly much, much more bizarre. So, I'm already laughing. Okay, there's this character called Makun, a guy who knows the human characters as friends, but is in absolute love with Ebuchu. When I say love, I mean, yeah, that kind of love. He's like this white knight of hers and tries to love on Ebuchu and protect her and buy her stuff and is essentially the only person in the entire anime who is actually nice to Ebuchu. It's a very good running gag that leads to a joke that gave me the biggest belly laugh in the entire series. So Makun here has a girlfriend, and occasionally he'll think about Ebuchu while being with his girlfriend just to get him aroused, which says a lot about him. He was having these dreams about Ebuchu hitting on him, and with every single time him waking up out of the dream in a very particular way that I can't show you all because YouTube will shoot me out of a cannon, all right? Just know that he wakes up from his dreams and he's very excited. And this happens like 8 times in a row where he just keeps waking up and waking up. Every dream is actually a dream. It's actually a dream. It's dreamception, right? And my God, did it get a big laugh out of me. Other noticeable moments in the show include Ebuchu running into her master's room like some kind of referee and interrupting sex because the guy wasn't doing it correctly. There's also Ebuchu showing up at her master's office and telling everyone there her dirty secrets. She eats her master's food, and every single time Ebuchu is like, oh no, I'm going to be murdered, which is like pretty accurate. And then there's this legendary conversation where Ebuchu answers the phone to some like weird stalker guy who's asking questions, and let's just say every single question that he requests, Ebuchu answers to the greatest of satisfaction, to the point where the guy cries from joy. It's hilarious.
A sake bottle to the head. The boyfriend getting
being roofied so he wouldn't leave the girlfriend for the night. Ebuchu being drowned at the beach. It is all hilarious to me. A good old helping of dirty, dark comedy that fits so well in this cute chibi anime about a hamster who is on the verge of death in every single episode. I love it. So, what are my overall thoughts about Ebuchu? The story, the dialogue, the animation, that kind of stuff. Well, as you can already tell, I'm a big fan of the characters and writing. Ebuchu is just delightfully annoying. She lacks any sense of self-awareness and is so obsessed with her master that she can't tell when her filter is broken. Oh, my master is super sexy. She has like 20 pairs of frilly underwear, says Ebuchu to the master's mom. The mother's mortified, so is the master. Everyone's mortified except Ebuchu. But here's the thing. Everybody in this show is pretty terrible, and that includes Ebuchu. Now, she's not nearly as bad as the master or the boyfriend, but she has her scummy moments and can be selfish at times. She'll eat your food if you're not watching, and also tell strangers your deepest, darkest secrets without asking for your consent first. I guess it's part of the fun chemistry with Ebuchu and the rest of the cast. The master and the boyfriend are pretty awful, so to see them get publicly humiliated is quite entertaining, though that is typically followed up with, you guessed it, violence. Though there is the occasional moment where Ebuchu and her master are on the same page and team up. Because despite the beatings, Ebuchu genuinely loves her master and is concerned about her well-being. Though how she tries to help isn't helpful. But hey, that's the fun part, isn't it? I gotta say, as an American, I get a hoot out of Japanese entertainment. Especially when culturally exclusive things to Japan are featured in their movies and shows. Like, I never knew how much emphasis was put on the mid-20s for Japanese people to get married. It's like a curse to them. And that's an interesting running theme to me in Ebuchu. Of course, all of this is amplified by the animation. I love these character designs. Simple, soft, cute, with watercolor backgrounds. An effective, minimalistic approach that is the perfect juxtaposition for the murdering of a chibi hamster. The sex. The drunken, lustful stupor. The violence. It's like the polar opposite of what you would expect with these kinds of designs. But that's the point. It makes me think about Shin-Chan with its cute and simple designs and how it works off of the crude and somewhat mature characters in the show. Again, great stuff. I love it. Though not nearly as much as this guy loves Ebuchu. God, man, do not walk inside a pet store. Well, hold on, he did. Get out of there. So, in conclusion, Ebuchu was a delightful surprise to me, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I was expecting more surface-level jokes and content, but the characters are surprisingly fleshed out, with some very well-timed jokes and running gags throughout the series. Each time the episode was over, I quickly jumped into the next one. I was curious if Ebuchu could sink to even more embarrassing depths, and guess what? The answer is yes. Yes, she can. All in all, it is an extraordinarily fun adult anime. I absolutely adore the juxtaposition of this cute, chibi, adorable hamster who lacks any filter and just says whatever is on her dirty little mind. The soft colors, the simple designs. You'd think this show would be innocent, but that's the beauty of it. It's not. Instead, it is mature, sexually charged, and full of blunt force trauma. So if your sense of humor is twisted like mine, then I highly recommend Ebuchu. Now, hear me out, it is not for everyone. Some folks don't care for this tone of sexual stuff, and they most certainly can't stand little cute cartoon animals getting destroyed. But if you can accept that this is just a ridiculous adult anime, then there is a very good chance that you could enjoy it. I most certainly did. Something about adult comedy anime and this genre's bizarre and chaotic characters, visuals, and storytelling that just really do it for me. So if you guys know of any more shows that fall into this category, please let me know in the comments. I'm all about that deceptive content where you think, aw, it's so cute and kid-friendly, and then bam, the hamster's wearing BDSM gear and is now lying in a pool of its own blood in the corner of the apartment. Ah, Japan, never change.
Oh, this is a good game that came out recently. Infernax or something like that. I like it because it reminds me of, like, Castlevania if it was released today. Excuse me. I need to get some water soon. I'll go upstairs. Alright, it's been about 40 minutes. I'm gonna take a break really quick and be right back. I just need to go get some water or something. I'm incredibly thirsty right now. Excuse me. That's interesting. I guess he's doing the evil run through or something. Oh well. Just one moment. Yeah, I know, I know. I've seen enough of that already.
Hey everyone, guess what? It's me again. I really want to do a hedgehog build. I said this yesterday, and the truth is I didn't make a hedgehog build in the end yesterday, but I kind of really want to make a hedgehog build. You know, the clumsy swimmers, sure. Like, I just want... I don't even know if you can win with a hedgehog build, but I want, like, a really big hedgehog and a really big blowfish and maybe, like, an elephant in there and all that sort of stuff. You know? I just want to vibe for a bit, man. Oh, what a clean... I was about to say, what a clean victory that was. No, it was a draw, but I'm okay with that. We've got an otter lined up. Oh, my God, a third and. Let's get the otter on. Please put the fish. Okay, no, that'll do. There's another ant. Honestly, let's just buff this one. Make him like a super ant. Oh my god, how about this? Super, super ant. I am now just realizing this is maybe the worst idea I've ever had. What, have I merged all the ants into one already? I should have kept them separately. I'm aware of that. I think this is going to work out. Okay, I lied. I think we lose this quite drastically right now. Oh no. Yeah, hold up. It's a draw though. It's a draw. Let's go. I told you it'd work out, guys. It's just another draw. Yeah, give me some more ants, though. Honestly, I'll happily pick a hedgehog. That's a peacock, dude. I have to take one of these. Yo, the crab could be 3 and 6, though. Yo, the crab. The crab, though. The crab. Yo, the crab. He's 3 and 6. Okay. Let's go. Come on. We need the vibes today. We need the vibes. Yo, ant kills fish. Click.
What I want to do is get magnetite. But that's in the next city. But eventually I'll get good enough to do like a Nuzlocke or some type of weird challenge. Like only using fire types to beat in Pokemon game or something like that. Oh no, not Bianca. Hopefully this one has a good nature. Start getting out of control if I don't do something. Because even though it's a rock move, the freaking attack power will double. And dead. Bashful. Swarm. Thank you. Okay. She didn't like that one. Naughty and poison point. Naughty's plus attack, I know that. Minus special defense, poison point. Contact with Pokemon, poison to attacker. Honestly, something taken away from special attack on that particular Pokemon would have been fine too. But it needs all the defense it can have. I believe this one evolves at level 17 to Tepig. We'll see where that leads. One last battle in the tall grass. I want to slow this fool down so it doesn't get out of hand. Also want to switch into Tepig that can handle part of his bulk and speed up on him. I don't think it has like another Let's see. Dire hit. I believe that's a chance to hit or critical strike. Possibly both. Well, I should probably save. The Mareep is going to get replaced. The cat is probably going to get replaced. So we'll see. We will see. Thank you. Okay, so dire hit is the is that other one that I was talking about? I'm gonna run away from this one because it's literally like a waste of time. We want Marie to be at the front. See if we can get our next encounter. Thank you. we are just going to stop here for right now and be back a little bit later. I hope you all enjoyed this part of Pokemon. We're going to farm it out for a Magnemite, but I think it's rare and white. So we'll see. We'll see where everything stands a little bit later, but as of right now, we're gonna just take a little bit of a break and be back later, alright? Remember to check out the alternate channels and whatnot, and have a good one. Remember to take care of yourself.